Good afternoon, everyone. You're all very welcome to Eglish today. It's great to see you, great to be with you. And whether you're here in person or watching online or listening on CD, I pray God's richest blessing on you all today as we worship God together. So as Reverend Dodds is on holiday, we extend a very warm welcome this Sunday to our visiting speaker, Mr. Leslie Reid. Leslie, of course, needs no introduction. But it's really good to see you again, Leslie, and thank you for joining us. You really are welcome. We look forward to hearing what the Lord has led you to say this morning. So if you have your announcement sheet handy, just a few to highlight. And as mentioned, Reverend Dodds is on holiday until this Wednesday. So if you require the services of a minister during this time, please contact the Reverend James O'Neill. He's from New Mills and Carlin. The contact details there are on your announcement sheet. The midweek returns again this Wednesday evening at 8 p.m. here in Eglish with Owen leading. So just note the small mistake on the announcement sheet that says Atchison Hall, but just to confirm that it is here in the hall in Eglish at 8 p.m. on Wednesday evening. And then finally, just one thing that's not on the announcement sheet is that the organisation Good News for Everyone have asked us to announce that they're having their annual dinner this Friday night, that's the 21st of April, in Corrick House at 7:30. So if you're interested, please contact Leslie Holmes. I have his number here, I'll just call it out quickly. It's 077-303-1668. Contact him by tomorrow so they can confirm numbers, and come see me if you need that number, I'll give it to you. But so those are all the announcements, so just that I wanted to highlight at this point. So before Leslie speaks, I'm just going to hand over to Owen to lead us in the call to worship. Thank you.
Thank you, Jeff. What a privilege it is this morning to come together to worship the God who loved us so much that he sent his one and only Son to die on the cross for our sins. And for our call to worship this morning, I want to bring us to Psalm 62 and reading verses 5-8. And they read, "For God alone, O my soul, wait in silence. For my hope is from him. He only is my rock and my salvation, my fortress. I shall not be shaken. O God, rest my salvation. On God, rest my salvation and my glory. My mighty rock, my refuge is God. Trust in him at all times, O people. Pour out your hearts before him. God is a refuge for us." And what a privilege it is to say that we can have our refuge in God, God, the creator of heaven and earth, that we can place our trust in him for all that we need, for all our struggles, the things that may be weighing down on us today. Come to him now. Come to him in worship. Come to him in song. And we do that now as we come to our first piece, "When Peace Like a River." Isn't that right? Yes. So let's stand and sing it together now.
Oh,
before I hand over to Leslie, let's just still our hearts before the Lord our God in prayer. So let's pray together now. Heavenly Father, what a privilege that it is to say that it is well with our soul. That we have peace like a river in our hearts because our sin was nailed to the cross. You are our refuge. We come to you for our hope and our strength this very day. Lord, help us. No matter what is burdening us, that is weighing down our minds, help us to let go of it, to place it into your hands and ready our hearts to receive your word today. Heavenly Father, we pray that you will guide us today. You will help Leslie as he brings your word to us and leads us in the rest of this service. And Lord, we pray that it would be a blessing to us. Be a blessing to each and every one of us, no matter where we are, no matter what is happening in our lives. And Lord, we pray that you be with us now. And we ask all these things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Yeah. Thank you, Owen. It's great to be back. It's like coming to my granny's house, coming to see us all. And it's so good to see so many familiar faces who 8 years ago, since I was working here more in a pastoral role. But Brenda, Adrian and Liam are at the back as well. They're also here. They have to endure me again for another couple of hours. I'm only kidding, not a couple of hours. Hopefully within the hour. But seriously, it is good. I'm going to ask the boys and girls, I think they're all here, probably around the front row, to stay where you are, basically, and I'm going to come down, just share for a few moments with you. Thank you. Hi, Ayes. These are all older than the kids in Castle Coffee. So I want to ask you a question. If you don't know, ask your mum. I'm going to ask. She's close by. Or granny or anybody else in the congregation. Does anybody know what the word comfort or console mean? Hazard a guess. Yeah, that's right. Yeah. Very good. Anybody else? I'm going to ask Owen. Her, okay. Yeah.
To reassure, to help them in the time of need.
Yeah. Another question, this is probably a bit more of a technical question. Does anybody know how to make a vertical and a horizontal line? What's this line here going across? Horizontal. Very good. And what's this one? Vertical, that's right. And when we think about our relationship with God, which one do you think this is here? Vertical, very good. And how we are with each other? Everybody else? Horizontal, very good. We are here on planet Earth in Eglish this morning, so we're all on the same level. I'm a wee bit higher up, and Jeff's up there, up at the top there as well. But I'm going to turn to Scripture, because there's a verse of Scripture, and you're going to hopefully be able to tell me which one fits in where. It's 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 4. Who comforts us in all our troubles. Do you think that is horizontal or vertical? Vertical. Very good. I'm glad you came this morning. So your mum and dad and granny as well. But also, the second part as well is probably going to be easy because you've answered the first part. So that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves have received from God. Aye, horizontal, brilliant. And that's very important. Do we ever get sad, lonely, fearful at school, with our friends, at home? Who do we turn to for help normally? When you're in trouble or feeling down, depressed or sad, we shouldn't be depressed with your children. Yeah, mum, dad, teacher when you're in school. God, of course somebody said Jesus. Well, they're very spiritual over in Castle Caulfield. I want to tell you a story about a little boy called Tom. He went to school one day, very sad. This is because his dad was really, really sick and he was very, very worried about him. It is strange because sometimes when we're sad and lonely, We can feel that we're the only ones, something, we're the only ones that's happening to. We can feel like really alone. The world's passing us by and everybody's forgotten about us. We can feel like that. The older people as well as kids. Tom was having these feelings. All the other kids were playing and having fun at break time. In class, all the kids were able to answer all the questions, but he was totally lost in his thoughts and everything. He was feeling worse and worse until another boy called Sam came up to him and asked him, what was the matter at dinner time? This is a true friend, going up to somebody and saying, oh, how are you? How are you feeling? You're looking a wee bit down on it, down in the dumps, we would say. Tom was a wee bit hesitant to tell Sam at the beginning, but then told him about his dad, what was going on, that he wasn't well. Sam comforted him and told him it was okay, that if it was okay for him to tell his own parents to pray in the church that they were going to, in a Christian church, at their prayer meeting, to pray for Tom's dad. And it got me thinking about what it means to be a Christian. And I love, Doreena, my daughter, did this memory verse. She loves art. And it's this memory verse says, Galatians 6, verse 2. What does it say? Boys and girls, adults as well, everybody under the age of 100. I think Adam says everybody here this morning. We're going to, if maybe the people at the back can't see, but I'm going to shout it out. Carry each other's burdens, and in this way, you will fulfill the law of Christ. Okay? We'll say it again. Galatians chapter 6, verse 2. Carry each other's burdens, and in this way, you will fulfill the law of Christ. Just one more time. Galatians chapter 6, verse 2. Carry each other's burdens, and in this way, you will fulfill the law of Christ. Brilliant. That's great. Thank you. And we're going to sing now the hymn for the boys and girls. It's Mission Praise, 746. What a friend we have in Jesus. Because we can find our consolation and comfort from other people. But guess what? Jesus is always a prayer away. So we're going to sing now 746. Thank you, Valerie.
Yeah.
That's great singing. Thank you, Valerie. We're going to turn now to God's Word. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 3 to 7. Thank you. In your pew Bibles, you will find it also. This is the Word of God. 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 3 to 7. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our troubles, so we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves have received from God. For just as the sufferings of Christ flow over into our lives, so also through Christ our comfort overflows. If we are distressed, it is for your comfort and salvation. If we are comforted, it is for your comfort, which produces in you patient endurance of the same sufferings we suffer. And verse 7, and our hope for you is firm, because we know that just as you share in our sufferings, so also you share in our comfort. We, the Lord, will bless this reading of his word. Amen. We're going to pray now. We're going to pray for our minister here, Mark, and Claire and the family as they're on holiday and their safe return. Also those who are ill and waiting on test results. Also for peace in our land, 25 years, supposedly without any violence. We know that has not been the case. We want to pray for our country and our world as well, not just our own little country, but the whole world, which needs Jesus so much. And lastly, we're going to pray for our youth fellowship, which meets every other Sunday. So let's bow our heads just for a few moments, and we're going to commit this to the Lord. Lord, we do thank you for calling Mark and Claire and the family here to both Eglish and Castle Coffee. Thank you for their ministry, and we pray that you will continue to use them for many more years to come to reach out to minister to those who know you, but also to reach out to those yet who do not know you. God, thank you for the call upon their lives to come and to minister in these two congregations. And we pray that their time away will be refreshing and revigorating, and they will come back enthused about the work that you have called them to here in Eglish and Castle Caulfield. We do pray also, Lord, for those who are ill within the congregation, those waiting on results. We also pray for the housebound, those in nursing homes and hospital and so forth, Lord. We pray that they would put their faith and trust in you, God. As we know, when sickness comes, it is like an alarm clock ringing, as I've heard before mentioned in the sermon, Lord. It's like an alarm clock ringing. It just depends that we waken up from our slumber. So we just pray, God, that we will waken up ourselves, God, from our spiritual slumber, and also to be aware of you calling into our lives, of waking us up, Lord, when we are spiritually sleeping. So we just pray for us all, Lord. We pray for our country here in the world. We do pray for Northern Ireland. We just pray, God, for peace that will last. We know that we've been celebrating 25 years of the Good Friday Agreement. Many of us remember that being signed. And we know there's been a lot less violence, but it's still not completely healed the country. We know only Jesus ultimately can heal, bring healing to any country, not just here, but in any country around the world. So we just pray for our only country here in Northern Ireland. We do pray also for the situations that are going on. Just hearing about in Sudan, Africa, there's been a trouble again between rival groups, Lord, the government and rebels. We just pray for a cessation of violence there. And we pray for peace in Khartoum, the capital of Sudan. And also we think of Ukraine, which is never very... which is very often in our news, Lord, we read about on a daily basis. We just pray for Vladimir Putin to pull his army out and to see this is a fruitless exercise and it's just causing wanton destruction and death, Lord. We just pray, God, that good will come out of it. We pray for the Church of Ukraine, as well as our brothers and sisters as well in Russia who haven't endured Vladimir Putin and his regime. We pray, God, for peace, lasting peace, in that part of the world also. We just also lastly pray for the youth ministry in these two congregations. We pray for those who lead the youth work, those who get alongside the young people, because we're all struggling, Lord. When we were younger, there was different struggles. Today, I think it's even worse, harder, Lord, and more challenging to be a young person, especially a young person who wants to go on with God, with the temptations of this world, of the age that we're living in, with multimedia, and just so much out there, Lord. which is certainly not gratifying to you, Lord, or glorifying to you. So we just pray for our young people, particularly the youth fellowship, that the themes they're studying and looking at and their times together socially and every other way, Lord, that as they build up relationships, the most of all in the horizontal, the vertical also will be built up, their relationship first and foremost with you, Lord Jesus. So we just pray this all in and through the name of Jesus. Amen. We're going to sing again. We're going to sing a lovely old hymn, Guide Me, O Thou Great Jehovah, Mission Praise 201. Thank you, Valerie. I've been thinking a lot lately about the word consolation. Due to my own circumstances of late, it's really hit home to me. Regrets, if only, fears, worries, anxieties seem to follow us all, not just me, but each one of us around most of our days. This adds more stress to life, and we find ourselves in a vicious circle going round and round and round. The world's attitude, of course, towards all this is either to go into positive thinking mode, or mind over matter, or some New Age philosophy, it will pan itself out, or ignore the issue altogether. Basically, bury your head into the ground like an ostrich. But how should we, who profess Jesus Christ, if we say we're born again and love the Lord Jesus, deal with these issues when they come to our door? Because guess what? They come to all of our doors. We have been, we are presently, or guess what? We will be going through difficulties and problems. The Webster's Dictionary 1828 says, I wasn't around back then, I don't maybe look at sometimes, console, to comfort, to cheer the mind in distress or depression, to alleviate grief and to give refreshment to the mind or spirits, to give contentment or moderate happiness by relieving from distress. Let us turn now to God's Word. I read it a bit earlier on. Let's see what the Bible says. How do we deal with it? How do we deal with stress, pressures of life, and all the anxieties and fears and worries we all face? Whether we're Christian or not here this morning, you know, we all face on a daily basis. I'm going to use the word comfort as is written in 2 Corinthians 1 in the NIV. The Authorized Version uses both console and comfort interchangeably. Incredible is written 10 times, you'll find, in NIV, you'll find 10 times, which is incredible. That's like average, like two a verse. And the word comfort in just five verses, verses 3-7. The context of what we're going to look at this morning, we'll see a wee bit later on in verses 8 to 11, why Paul was writing to this church in Corinth about this whole issue of comfort. Why was he writing? There's always a reason why things are written, especially in the letters in the New Testament. I'm going to read these three verses. Maybe this will give you an idea of why Paul was writing and what he was going through himself. So he was experiencing it, and he was also sharing it also with this church in Corinth. Verse 8 says, "We do not want you to be uninformed, brothers and sisters, about the troubles we experienced in the province of Asia. We were under great pressure, far beyond our ability to endure. So we despaired of life itself. Indeed, we felt we had received a sentence of death." That's pretty grim, isn't it? "But this happened that we may not rely on ourselves, but on God, who raised the dead." Verse 10 says, "He has delivered us from such a deadly peril, and he will deliver us again. On him we have set our hope that he will continue to deliver us." And verse 11, just to finish, "As you help us by your prayers, then many will give thanks on our behalf for the gracious favor granted us in answer to the prayers of many." Paul was writing from Macedonia after having to flee Ephesus. You know, the book of Ephesians was written to the church of Ephesus. Paul, who wrote that book also, modern-day Turkey, where he labored, was laboring for over 2 years. He had already written 1 Corinthians while he was there. In 1 Corinthians 16, verse 9, this is a tremendous wee verse, gives us a wee clue to how things were going for him. Great things were happening, but when you hear this verse, which jumped out at me when I read it, I think, wow, that's amazing. Good and bad, like when you hear this here, what Paul says, "Because a great door for effective work has opened for me." Well, guess what? A door of witness to bring the gospel of hope into that sick world at that particular time. Hope, you know, effective work, you know, seeking to reach men and women, boys and girls with the gospel. But when you hear the second part of this verse, "And there are many who oppose me," but that's the downside, where we know God is at work, Satan, the counterfeit, will come in and depress and get down and distress even the saints of God. He was facing persecution also in Acts 19, verses 23 to 41. We're not going to look at that today. Tells us his enemies basically wanted him dead. He managed to get away just about and to move on to Macedonia. Talk about pressure and stress. Let us go back to these verses found in verses 3 to 7 in this chapter 1, and see how we should deal with this issue ourselves of the pressures and the stresses that affect our lives so much, so we can actually apply scripture into our lives even in 2023. Who ultimately gives us comfort? The boys and girls. We were looking at it a bit earlier on. God gives us comfort. Verse 3. The creator of the universe, who created us all, and who knows us all intimately, whether we're Christian or not. That's the amazing thing. He loves us all and cares for us all. I love what Psalm 139 tells us about King David in verses 1 to 4. What do you hear what says? David says, "You have searched me, O God, O Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my goings out and my lyings down. You're familiar with all my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely." Wow, just let that sink in for a moment. We can become so engrossed, so taken up by hearing scripture in our daily lives, but not really understanding it, grappling with it, and really wrestling with scripture sometimes. You know, so we really understand what it really means, but also seek and apply it into our lives, even the whole issue of praise. How to respond to him? Yes, with praise, not just on a Sunday morning when you're in the tractor in the office, wherever you find yourself, schoolroom, wherever you may find yourself, in your day job, whatever, or you're retired as well, where God has you in this lot, this station in your life, for the boys and girls in school as well, and all their commitments. He is indeed the Father of compassion and God of all comfort. And I love the word all here as well. It's interesting here, and that also jumped out on me when I was reading the passage. Not literally, but figuratively. The word all is interesting here and can be easily missed when reading it. All means to refer to the whole quantity or extent of a particular group or thing. That's what the dictionary told me. That means everything, basically nothing is beyond God's reach. Verse 3 can seem very general, but Paul is more specific at the beginning of verse 4. We hear what says here, Paul says. We actually read it earlier on to the boys and girls, who comforts us in all our troubles. On Friday afternoon, I went to visit a lady in Ballyclare. I went to a funeral in Strait, and I went to visit her. A lovely Christian woman who has terminal cancer. We don't know how long she's left in this world. But guess what? She gave me hope. She comforted me. God used her to comfort me. I came in just to visit her and see her. She was hopefully to pray with her and read scripture. But guess what? She really ministered to me and really spoke into my heart. So God uses people, as we looked earlier on with the boys and girls, that God uses each other here, like iron sharpens iron. Isaiah reminds us, we sharpen each other. Are we sharpening each other? God spoke to me through her. Many here this morning, this afternoon, can also testify to God's comfort in their lives. Every situation was and is very different. But guess what? He was and can comfort us in every situation in our lives. Everything, no matter what happens, no matter what our lot in life is at the moment, God knows, and that is so key. If you don't remember anything I say this morning, just remember God knows. He knows. Another thing here, as well as in verses 5 to 6, the preposition for, beginning of verse 5, gives us that clue. Just as the sufferings of Christ flow into our lives, all the difficulties and problems of life, even in this year, 2023, so also his comfort. Jesus himself sums it up really well in John 16, verse 33. I have told you these things so that in me, not in me, or in a minister or a pastor or in any one of us, but in Jesus, you may have peace. In this world, guess what? You will have trouble. Not you may have trouble, you could have trouble, but it's very strong here, the verb. It says you will have trouble. But take heart, I have overcome the world. Yes, the good and the bad. The word flows. I love this here description. And in verse 5, it talks about flow, but also overflow. So flow is the difficulties, the problems, the hassles of life, and all the things that come upon us on a daily basis. Sometimes we want to give up, you know, and it's just so difficult. But guess what? The overflow of God, we can reach out to that overflow, God, at any given time. That resource is always there for us, 24/7. The difficulties flow, yes, but also his comfort overflows. The emphasis being on the greater, overflowing like a waterfall. Like a small waterfall is the flowing, but a greater waterfall is his blessing in our lives. The overflow of God in my life, in your life. But guess what? Only if you trust him and are in a relationship, living, active, daily walk with Jesus Christ. When I was thinking about this, I was thinking, wow, and then I thought of chapter 4. Further on, verses 14 to 16, we hear what it says here. Therefore, we do not lose heart. We don't give up. We don't throw in the towel. Though outwardly, we are wasting away. That is reality for every one of us. We're all wasting away. Yet inwardly, we're being renewed day by day. By the Holy Spirit, if we're in Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit's working in our lives every day. For our light and momentary, I love that phrase, light and momentary. That means it's temporal. It's not going to go on forever. Your suffering and pain, whatever you're going through this morning or have gone through or will go through, we are, have, or will be going through troubles, are achieving for us. So there's a purpose and a meaning in it all. An eternal glory that far outweighs them all. When you put it on the scales, when we think of the scales of life, guess what? Jesus wins, you know? That's why we're here this morning. Jesus wins in our lives, in all of our lives, if we trust in him. So we fix our eyes. If we're not fixing our eyes, yes, we got to look around us and see what's going on in the world. What is seen, but not... So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen. Since what is seen is temporary. Guess what? This building is temporary. It's not going to be forever. Heaven is eternal. Many of our loved ones are in heaven today. Praise God. One day we will be there. We're living in a temporal body. So we see here at the end, I just want to repeat it again. But what is unseen? But on what is unseen? Since what is seen is temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. So we cannot see God physically. We know he's there. We believe heaven is real. By faith, we trust the Lord Jesus Christ. And we believe the scriptures to be true and faithful. So we trust in the word of God. In 2 Corinthians 1, 6-7, Paul gets even more specific. If this is specific, this is even getting more deeper and directly addresses the Christians in Corinth. If you are afflicted, if we are afflicted, it is for your comfort and salvation. And if we are comforted, it is for your comfort, which you experience when you patiently endure the same sufferings that we suffer. Indeed, there is no purpose. There's a purpose in all of this. We all know Romans 8:28. All things work together for good. This is this word again. All things, everything that happens in your life has a reason or purpose. Even though at the exact time you maybe don't realize it, reminds us of that. Paul's suffering that he was going through to the point of death. You know, it's pretty depressing reading verses 8 to 11. You know, until you read verses 3 to 7. Paul's suffering was going to be a testimony for them. Because guess what? They were going to be suffering as well. Maybe persecution as well in Corinth. He brings that home in verse 7. They will suffer also, yes. But also they will have the same comfort. The flowing is the pain, the suffering, the overflowing is greater and mightier and bigger because it's from God. I love what 1 Corinthians 26 reminds us of as we go back to this whole thing about church and community and what we're about in consoling and comforting each other when we're going through difficulties and problems. Maybe a small thing, maybe a big issue. If one part suffers, anybody here suffering, everybody suffers with them or her. If one part is honored, if things are going well, every part rejoices with it. So you get the positive and the negative here together. In our individualistic world we live in here in the West, particularly Western Europe, this is so refreshing. We need each other more than we realize. And this is where we find real community. And this ties in with a part of verse 4. Just to go back to that verse 4 again. So we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves receive. Because I cannot give comfort to anybody else if I don't have that comfort from God, from Christ. I need to receive so I can give. Like a sponge, I need to soak up his presence, but also I need to, you know, soak out his presence into other people's lives. It may not be the same problem issue. And I was reading through a commentary about this, and I always thought, oh, if I have cancer, and I can go, if I'm healed, then I can go and help somebody else who has cancer. But that does not necessarily may be the case. You know, it could be another issue or problem. But we have the same consolation in Christ. Whatever we have had in the past, we can also comfort and strengthen each other. And that's so, so important that we are looking out for each other as a community. I love what John 13, this is really the crux of the matter here. Verse 35 says, by this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. Love is the key, isn't it? How will we reach our communities? Yes, we can have missions, outreaches, and lots of programs and reaching out. And these are all very important to reach out to the community and ourselves and to non-Christian folk. But to love one another, there are no shortcuts. To really care and to be looking out for one another is the core of the gospel, of what God wants us to do. The vertical, our relationship with him, but also the horizontal, reaching out to each other in whatever way, capacity, to children, to young people, to older folk, retired folk, middle-aged, whatever station they are at in life, whatever situation they may be going through. As I tie all this together this morning, this sermon, what is spoken into your heart? The fact that ultimately it's God's, the Lord who comforts us, you know, that he's the one ultimately. Other people, I can comfort people, but guess what? God comforts more because of this book, the Bible. If I didn't have this book, how could I comfort anybody? I didn't get anybody comfort because of the word of God, the Bible. We we can comfort folk who are going through difficulties and problems. And I've been, I'm sure Mark and Owen have been in many living rooms of people who have lost loved ones. And guess what? We don't turn to any of our philosophy. We turn to the Word of God, because there is the only hope for the world is Jesus Christ. Will that change our attitude towards how we worship Him? Not just on a Sunday morning. We don't even have to worship God on a Sunday. We can worship Him in the office, in work, wherever we are, school. If we're retired, we can worship God as well. You have a ministry of prayer in your own home. So we can worship God in so many different ways, because that is the response to everything God has given to us. If you're not yet a Christian, if you aren't too sure about knowing Lord Jesus, can you grasp for the first time His comfort for you that only He can give? You cannot have this comfort. As I said before, we cannot have the comfort to give to others if we don't have that comfort in our own lives. You know, if I don't know Lord Jesus Christ, how can I comfort other people? It's impossible, you know. Have you done this? Have you accepted Lord Jesus Christ into your heart and life? If not, why not? What's holding you back, you know? Do we seek to comfort each other? Are we Christians not only in name, but in action also? In practical Christianity, looking out for each other and being there for an hour, each other, a WhatsApp message, whatever. Just some homework here for everybody, please. This week, for 5 minutes a day to worship and praise the Lord. Scripture reminds us, those who seek me with all their hearts shall find me. So if you really seek God with all of our hearts, guess what? You'll find Him. He's not far away from any one of us. Indeed, the Bible says, the psalmist says, He's close to us than hands or feet. If you are not a Christian, pray and seek the Lord. Ask Mark or one of Jeff, say the elders, only one Jeff, and the elders, how you can become a Christian. You know, or anybody here who's godly, who loves the Lord Jesus Christ, how you can become a believer. Practical ways, like I said before, a phone call, getting in touch with folks, seeing how they are. A WhatsApp message or someone going through a hard time. Because guess what? As I said before, we have been, we are presently, or we will be going through a difficult time. And as we live in this world of just so many problems and difficulties, but we have the consolation of trusting the Lord Jesus Christ. We're going to have a wee prayer now, just a wee prayer of response before we sing our last hymn. So let us just pray. Lord, we do thank You and praise You, God. I try to bring a lot of stuff out there in a short period of time. But hopefully, Lord, well, not hopefully, I believe, Lord, that You, God, will speak to every heart here present, God, because You know where we're at. Where we're deceiving ourselves, deceiving You, Lord, You know our hearts, God. So we just pray, God, that You, Lord, will continue speaking into our hearts, consoling us, Lord, comforting us, Lord, where we're at, Lord Jesus. You know where, as every head differs, every knee differs. So we just come to You, Lord. I'm passionate about this because I believe the gospel. It's all about change, changing lives, changing churches, changing communities, Lord, so we become more like Jesus, so we can reach this nation for Christ, we can reach this world for Christ. Thank You and praise You for each one here. We know we're not here by accident, Lord. We know oops is not in Your vocabulary. Indeed, Lord, You brought us here this morning because we're excited to be here, not just going through the motion of going to church for an hour, putting in an hour of religion or just tradition. No. We're here because we love You and we want to know You more, Lord. We pray this all in Jesus' name. As we sing, Lord, this last hymn, Lord, may we sing it with all our hearts and really think about the words. We pray this all in Jesus' precious name. Amen. We're going to sing a lovely, lovely piece, a more modern piece, by the Hetty Gettys, In Christ Alone. Thank you, Valerie.
Oh,
all of us need to stand, standing in your power, standing, Lord, in your authority, not ours, because we have none. Thank you and praise you that in you, Lord, we have life and that life abundant, Lord. We look at our world completely broken and fallen and getting worse. But Lord, we have hope because of Jesus. If I didn't have hope, I would have thrown in the towel a long time ago. But I do believe in Jesus. I believe so passionately in the gospel. And I do believe it is the salvation of everyone here, from the youngest person to the oldest. Lord, we all need Jesus. We need more of thee every day, Lord. Help us, Lord, to live that life out daily, not just in a church building or hall, but in our lives, in our homes, our families, our workplaces, wherever you have put us, Lord. And we pray this all in and through the name of Jesus. Protect us. Continue to be with us, Lord, in wherever you have us in life, Lord, that we will continue to trust in thee, Lord. We pray this in Jesus' precious, wonderful name. Amen.